There's over 2.3 million species that we know of on this planet, and there's bound to be millions more. But with so many species, how do scientists tell them apart? Hey guys, Julia here for D News. The Tree of Life is huge. Huge! According to a draft published in the journal Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, the latest draft of the Great Tree named over 2.3 million species of animals, plants, fungi, and bacteria. Previous versions of the Tree of Life only charted about 100,000 species at a time, but this new huge tree is truly an awesome sight to behold. To get a close-up look at the whole thing, check out tree.opentreeoflife.org. There's a link in the description if you're on mobile. But that got me wondering, with millions and millions of species on this planet, how do we tell them apart? Evolution is a beautiful thing. The branches of life spread out in every direction as life finds a way into every niche imaginable. A new species arises in a process called speciation. It's when something happens to separate it from all that came before, like a new trait or geological isolation. Naturalists like Charles Darwin used to tell species apart the old-fashioned way, just by looking at them, which is called morphology. It's telling species apart by their appearance. But there's another way to define a species, biologically. I've often heard a species defined as animals that can reproduce and make a viable, fertile offspring. Basically, if two animals can make a baby that lives and then can later make its own baby, then those two animals are the same species. Which is basically what the biological species concept says. This concept was introduced by biologist Ernst Mayr in the mid-20th century. He said species are groups of interbreeding natural populations that are reproductively isolated from other such groups. But both of these definitions aren't perfect. Life finds a way. So sometimes creatures that look wildly different can breed, like take dog breeds for example. If you're an alien taxonomist coming to Earth for the first time, you might be very confused by how all these creatures, from the smallest chihuahua to the greatest dane, could possibly be the same species. On the other hand, a group of animals that look an awful lot alike can actually be different species. In some cases, different species evolved similar traits because they're in similar environments, like foxes and cats, which cannot reproduce, or different species might be closely related and look a lot alike, but can't produce fertile offspring like horses and donkeys. Sure, they can produce a hybrid called a mule, but they're usually sterile. But even on a finer level, sometimes scientists get a surprise and find that different species might not be so different after all. And that's just the trouble a group of scientists in Australia ran into. In a study published in the journal Biology Letters, researchers found that different species of rock wallabies were swapping DNA. Six different species of rock wallaby were thought to be separate species because the way their genetic material was packaged, it would stop an offspring from being fertile. But upon genetic analysis, the researchers found gene flow between the species, suggesting something else was going on, forcing them to rethink their evolution. This finding suggests that these animals were getting it on, making babies that could then make some more babies. The rock wallabies might not be reproductively isolated, possibly meaning they were more like a single species than previously thought. Like in the case of these rock wallabies, scientists could see a species history written in its DNA. Thanks to modern technology, molecular genetic sequencing changed the game in biology and taxonomy. By comparing the DNA of different animals, scientists can see how they're related or not. This was a huge advance in the field of taxonomy. It's how we know our closest cousins are chimps and bonobos. If we went by morphology alone, perhaps we'd think orangutans were our next of kin. According to a study published in the journal Biogeography, we share more physical features with orangutans, like beards on men and similar shoulder blades. But molecular genetics revealed we share only 97% of our DNA with them and 99% with chimps and bonobos. So it can help us learn not just about the rest of the world, but taxonomy helps us find our place in the animal kingdom too. Some people think taxonomy and naming species is kind of dumb because it does seem somewhat arbitrary. I mean, humans are the ones deciding where those lines between species are, but I think it's really important because humans need to categorize things to make sense of this crazy, chaotic world. And it's so important to keep track of all the diversity of life on this planet while it's still here. There's a real risk we're losing species before we can even find them and name them. So no, taxonomy isn't perfect, but it's the best we've got. Taxonomy helps us know our history, like when recently scientists announced the discovery of yet another human-like ancestor. So Julian asked the question, how do we determine if they belong to the genus Homo? In this great episode, right here.
When we find a new species and put it in the genus Homo, it's a big deal. But how do we figure out what species deserves the honor of being called Homo? Well, the skull is a good place to start.
All right, friends, if you haven't heard the news yet, we're doing a live show right here in San Francisco. I'm so excited. We've got a great lineup of all your favorite hosts. I'll be there, Trace will be there, Julian, Amy, and Crystal will be there too. And we've got so many special guests like Dr. Joe Hansen from It's Okay to Be Smart, and Brian Brushwood, magician, TV personality, and host of Scam School, anthropologist Natalia Reagan, and Dr. Karen Bondar, Discovery Channel host and TED presenter. It's all going down October 22nd, so grab your tickets before they're gone. There's a link down in the description. Hope to see you there. All right, guys, so the real question is, what hybrid animal would you want to see? Tell us down in the comments below. Don't forget to hit those like and subscribe buttons so you don't miss a single DNews episode.